Comencem la sessió del matí, que sota un títol genèric que es diu Can Teaching Have Higher Prestige in Higher Education, hem volgut convidar dos professors, el professor Javier Paricio, de la Universitat de Saragossa. Bon dia, buenos días, Javier.
Gracias.
I el professor Paul Blackmore, del King's College London. Good morning, professor Blackmore. Thank you for coming here to Barcelona. La idea és que ells dos faran una ponència cadascú i després tindrem una estona pel debat amb tots vosaltres. Simplement introduir el primer ponent. Javier Paricio és professor titular de la Facultat d'Educació de la Universitat de Saragossa, adjunto al rector para innovación docente y responsable de la calidad de las titulaciones de esta universidad entre los años 2008 a 2012, director del ICE de la misma universidad entre 2003 y 2008 y implicado en el apoyo a los proyectos de innovación docente en la misma universidad. Es miembro de la Junta Directiva de la Red Estatal de Docencia Universitaria, Red U, y miembro de las comisiones de verificación y acreditación de títulos de la Agencia de Calidad de Castilla y León. Asimismo, es miembro del grupo que recibió el primer premio de innovación educativa de la Universidad de Zaragoza el año 2014. Es investigador especializado en la calidad y mejora de la docencia en la educación superior y autor de numerosas publicaciones sobre el tema. Veo que el abstract has puesto un título específico que es Reconocimiento de la docencia y representaciones de lo que significa ser buen profesor o profesora en la universidad. Pues muchas gracias, Javier, por estar aquí.
Adelante. Muchas gracias a vosotros. Les he pedido a la organización si me podía levantar para poder interactuar un poquito mejor con la pantalla, así que con su permiso. Buenos días. Yo en realidad lo que quería traer aquí es simplemente una idea, así que como es solo una idea, la verdad es que espero que sea buena por mi bien, ¿no? La cuestión sobre el reconocimiento y el prestigio de la docencia, yo lo que creo es que hemos estado simplificándola en exceso, ¿no? Yo creo que en general tendemos a pensar que la cuestión del reconocimiento de la docencia tiene que ver sobre todo con los equipos rectorales o tiene que ver con las agencias de calidad. Es decir, que es una cuestión de voluntad política y que en el momento en que nuestros rectorados o en el momento en que las agencias de calidad decidan reconocer la docencia, ya entonces esto empezará a mejorar, ¿no? Yo creo que es una simplificación excesiva. Yo creo que al final las políticas universitarias en realidad responden a la creencia mayoritaria que tenemos sobre lo que es la docencia, ¿no? Creo que al final responden simplemente a lo que mayoritariamente vemos que debe ser. Y creo que este es exactamente el problema. Si lo vemos así, fíjense, en este sentido, ¿por qué habríamos de reconocer particularmente la docencia si de lo que se trata es de explicar bien lo que sabemos? O como mucho acudir puntualmente a nuestras clases y atender de manera cordial y accesible a nuestros estudiantes para resolver sus dudas. Si pensamos así, la docencia en realidad no tiene una gran dificultad comparada con la exigencia que plantea nuestra investigación. Pues ni tiene dificultad ni requiere una cualificación excesiva, ¿no? Por eso yo creo que el problema está en la imagen que tenemos compartida sobre lo que significa ser un buen profesor o una buena profesora, ¿no? Por eso, permítanme presentarles este problema de una manera un poquito más elaborada, ¿no? Si hacemos un pequeño esquema de los aspectos implicados en esta cuestión del reconocimiento de la docencia, yo creo que hay un triángulo mágico, ¿no?, en el que esto se resuelve, ¿no? Y es el triángulo que tiene, por un lado, como ven, la valoración, el reconocimiento, el prestigio de la actividad docente dentro de las universidades y también el prestigio que otorga a quienes hacen una buena docencia. Por el otro lado está, por supuesto, la evaluación, es decir, la evaluación parece inseparable de cualquier reconocimiento y, por otro lado, parece también inseparable del tercer vértice del triángulo, que es la calidad, la mejora, el desarrollo profesional del profesorado, ¿no? Yo creo que en este triángulo se juegan las cosas, ¿no? Solemos simplificar esto, ¿no? Porque solemos pensar que sencillamente por colocar una evaluación de la actividad docente, con eso ya va a mejorar la calidad y la mejora. Pero en realidad las evidencias, al menos que tenemos aquí, no nos dicen nada de eso, ¿no? Hemos implantado docencia en todas nuestras universidades y, sin embargo, eso ha sido un gran impulso para la calidad de la docencia, ha sido un gran impulso para el desarrollo profesional de nuestro profesorado. La verdad es que yo no creo que haya sido así. Yo creo que nuestra docencia ha mejorado, pero no creo que haya sido docencia, los programas docencia, los que han acabado por impulsar esa mejora, ¿no? Así que la relación entre evaluación y desarrollo profesional, o evaluación y calidad y mejora de la docencia, es algo más compleja de lo que nosotros pensamos, ¿no? Por supuesto, la evaluación está en relación directa al reconocimiento y al prestigio. Si no existe ninguna forma de evaluación, ¿cómo va a existir cualquier forma de reconocimiento, ¿no? Pero pensemos en la misma evidencia de docencia, ¿no? Hemos implantado todos estos sistemas de evaluación y en realidad hemos mejorado el reconocimiento de la actividad docente dentro de las universidades. Pues es dudoso que haya sido así, ¿no? Y desde luego parece muy razonable pensar que un mayor reconocimiento, un mayor prestigio de la actividad docente o del buen profesor o profesora dentro de la universidad contribuirá a que se impulse la calidad y la mejora, pero tampoco es necesariamente, podría ser así. Podría ser en algunos casos, pero en otros perfectamente no, ¿no? De hecho, podríamos pensar que si docencia da determinados tipos de reconocimientos en aquellos sistemas donde vemos que así es, ¿no? Y te reconoce determinados aspectos que pueden ser salariales o pueden ser aspectos de reducción de la docencia o cualquier tipo de recompensa de ese tipo, en realidad tampoco incide particularmente en la calidad de la mejora, ¿no? Así que lo que tenemos que esto es más problemático de lo que nos parece en primer término. Así que la propuesta tiene que ver con el hecho de que, desde mi punto de vista, la clave de esto, de que realmente este triángulo empiece a funcionar, es el disponer de una representación compartida, profunda, basada en la investigación de lo que significa ser un buen profesor o una buena profesora. Necesitamos ese marco. Mientras pensemos de forma simple lo que significa ser un buen profesor, es imposible que esto funcione. Permítanme el hacerles un pequeño diagrama, ¿no?, de cómo funciona. Si pensamos de una manera muy simple en la docencia, pensemos, por ejemplo, qué significa lo que hemos dicho de explicar con claridad los contenidos de la disciplina, esa puntualidad, esa accesibilidad y respeto. Si pensamos así de sencillo la docencia, la cualificación que requiere algo así es muy limitada. Realmente es muy poco. Podemos pensar en pequeños cursos para aclarar, para tener buenos recursos, para explicar bien las cosas, o podemos pensar en realidad, pero es muy poco recorrido. Es decir, la mejora posible, el recorrido profesional posible, es pequeñísimo, es muy pequeño. Realmente, ¿de qué estamos hablando cuando hablamos de recorrido? Y si es muy pequeño, el sistema de evaluación es igualmente simple. En realidad, si lo piensan, es exactamente lo que tenemos. Lo que tenemos es un sistema de evaluación muy simple. Es un sistema que sobre todo reconoce méritos, cuantitativamente, es decir, visto desde aquí es perfectamente coherente, reconoce el que participemos en nuestras comisiones académicas de diferente tipo, reconoce el que vayamos alguna vez a cursos, que hagamos alguna innovación, por supuesto que demos alguna asignatura en otro idioma, o reconoce desde las horas de dedicación docente, es decir, es todo cuantitativo. ¿Cómo no? Si en realidad, cualitativamente, hay poco que progresar. Así que ni hay mucho recorrido, ni hay, y la evaluación es necesariamente cuantitativa, ¿no? Y por lo tanto hay muy poquito espacio para el reconocimiento y el prestigio de la actividad docente. En cambio, si pensamos en un modelo basado en esa idea del scholarship of teaching and learning, de la idea de basada en la investigación, esa docencia basada en la investigación, la cosa se complica mucho, muchísimo. realmente, ¿no? Si pensamos en un montón de cualidades, desde sobre todo conseguir altos niveles de implicación de los estudiantes, lo que eso supone y la dificultad que se supone, o por ejemplo el ser capaz de diseñar para ellos, de ofrecerles retos académicos complejos, ¿no? Basados por supuesto en métodos activos y colaborativos, pero que lleven a la formación de competencias de alto nivel, esas que sabemos que de verdad fomentan la empleabilidad, ¿no? Esas competencias complejas de enfrentar a los estudiantes en situaciones complejas y mal estructuradas, ¿no? Todo eso es muy, muy complicado, ¿no? O por ejemplo, ligado a todo eso, desarrollar en condiciones la autonomía de nuestros estudiantes, su capacidad de autoevaluación, de criterio sobre sus propias realizaciones, ¿no? O, por ejemplo, organizar una interacción formativa intensa que soporte ese desarrollo de la autonomía del estudiante, ¿no? Y, por supuesto, muy ligado a esa idea de Scholarship of Teaching and Learning, la idea de construir nuestra enseñanza como un espacio de indagación, de investigación sobre nuestra propia docencia, ¿no? Sí, podríamos seguir con toda esa lista, ¿no? Y lo que veríamos es que la actividad docente comporta una cualificación muy elevada, de alto nivel. Y si consideramos una cualificación de alto nivel, entonces nuestro rango de mejora es enorme, es inalcanzable. Si pensamos en un profesor ideal en estos términos complejos, lo que vemos es que ninguno de nosotros llegará jamás a ese, por mucho tiempo que le dediquemos, ¿no? Y, por supuesto, lo que tenemos es un sistema de evaluación muy complejo, muchísimo más complejo del que tenemos ahora, que necesariamente pasa por evaluación entre pares, porque tiene una dimensión muy cualitativa. Y, claro, en ese marco sí que es posible pensar en un reconocimiento y prestigio de la actividad. Necesitamos, y esa es la propuesta, esa es la idea, si necesitamos también en nuestras universidades un marco de cualificación del profesor universitario, una representación compartida que nos diga cuáles son los niveles, dónde están los horizontes de desarrollo a los que podemos llegar, cuáles son los escalones en ese desarrollo, ¿no? Esta es una idea que, por supuesto, se ha desarrollado ya en otros países, tenemos buenos niveles. A mí me gustan particularmente dos referentes. Uno es el Australian University Teaching Criteria and Standards Framework, que organiza toda la visión de lo que es un buen profesor o una buena profesora universitaria en 5 niveles, ¿no? Como vemos, son 5 niveles cruzados con 7 dimensiones para hacerlo. O me gusta particularmente como el trabajo que se ha hecho en Reino Unido con el UK Professional Standards Framework, el UKPSF. El UKPSF trabaja a 4 niveles, con 3 grandes dimensiones, que a su vez se subdividen en criterios, los cuales van representando un escalón progresivo, una subida progresiva de lo que significa ser buen profesor, y establecen para todos, compartido, un marco de referencia de lo que significa una carrera docente. Y yo creo que eso es particularmente valioso y particularmente necesario si queremos empezar a hacer que ese triángulo empiece realmente a producir frutos. Luego le podemos preguntar al profesor Blackmore, ¿no?, su opinión, porque todos los sistemas tienen sus inconvenientes y tienen sus aportaciones, ¿no?, al sistema, ¿no? Así que siempre son sistemas que trabajan con niveles cruzados con dimensiones para producir esos retratos de esos diferentes niveles. Nosotros desde la Red Estatal de Docencia Universitaria, desde REDU, llevamos ya bastante tiempo trabajando en esto, y posiblemente algunos de ustedes recuerden que ya en el marco precisamente de esto, del CIDUI, ya en la primavera pasada trajimos a Joe Pitt para que nos hablase precisamente de cómo funcionaba el UKPSF y que nos hablase un poco de esas ventajas e inconvenientes para ilustrarnos. Y después tuvimos un seminario con ella y de hecho llevamos trabajando para intentar hacer una propuesta que presentaremos a los socios en los próximos días, ¿no?, sobre cuál podría ser un marco para nosotros, ¿no? Pero lo más importante es pensar las bases desde las que se hace ese marco, ¿no? Y me gustaría que viesen la comparación entre dos modelos distintos de entender esto, ¿no? Una es la que yo creo que es nuestra concepción mayoritaria, ¿no?, que es esa idea de la evaluación docente y el reconocimiento docente como una cuestión de méritos. Es algo que uno va rellenando en su saco. Está hecho sobre todo de papeles, de certificados de cursos, de certificados de pertenencia a no sé qué, de certificados de haber colaborado con no sé qué, certificados de innovación, etcétera, etcétera. Así que uno va llenando su bolsa de... Es un sistema que es por acumulación y, por supuesto, no implica que haya ningún cambio. Mi docencia puede seguir exactamente igual, pero voy acumulando méritos. Así que se supone que voy siendo cada vez mejor profesor, pero mi docencia no cambia. Eso es un auténtico milagro, ¿no? Y lo que medimos en nuestros sistemas es simplemente cantidad de dedicación. Si lo pensamos, es siempre cantidad. La cantidad de tiempo que dedicamos a esas comisiones, la cantidad de tiempo que dedicamos a hacer participar en el proyecto tutor de nuestro centro, la cantidad de tiempo... Son ese tipo de méritos. Es cantidad. No implica un salto cualitativo. Así que, en realidad, no hay progresión como tal. Frente a eso, lo que deberíamos intentar empezar a pensar es en un sistema de escalones, en un sistema cualitativo. Es decir, un sistema en el cual se reflejen tipos diferentes de planteamiento, niveles distintos de plantearse de la docencia. Y eso es lo que creo que marcará un horizonte de desarrollo profesional, que es al fin y al cabo lo que nos importa, ¿no? Es tener todos en la cabeza hacia dónde debemos empezar a caminar, estemos muy altos o estemos muy bajos, ¿no? para hacerlo. Eso sí que comporta, ese horizonte sí que comporta una progresión, un cambio, una mejora, ¿no? Y por supuesto, lo que estamos evaluando, cualquier sistema de evaluación, lo que evalúa son buenas prácticas basadas en la investigación y la medida en que hemos convertido nuestra propia docencia en un espacio de indagación y un espacio de investigación. Es radicalmente distinto al enfoque de evaluación que tenemos en este momento, ¿no? Yo creo que deberíamos empezar a pensar en estos términos, ¿no? Fíjense, por ejemplo, las bases sobre las que tenemos ese primer borrador, que podría cambiar muchísimo, por supuesto, cuando nuestra intención es que empiece a entrar en un debate en todas las universidades, en el cual podría cambiar, por supuesto, muchísimo, ¿no? Para hacerlo, pero la idea en el borrador es basarlo en cuatro escalones, cuatro niveles, ¿no? Un primer nivel para intentar hacerles un perfil rápido, ¿no? De cómo es el profesor o la profesora que está en cada uno de esos niveles, ¿no? El primer escalón que supone ya una subida es un nivel que podríamos llamar de aseguramiento. Son las cosas básicas que cualquier docente en la universidad debería cumplir, ¿no? Y uno debería cumplir, por ejemplo, que su planificación fuera transparente, estuviera publicada en algún sitio, tuviera publicada una guía docente o sus actividades, que se viera lo que hace, ¿no? Una transparencia mínima. O debería cumplir, por supuesto, unos estándares de transparencia en su evaluación, ¿no? O debería cumplir unos estándares en el feedback que da a sus estudiantes, ¿no? Eso son esas cuestiones simplemente de aseguramiento de lo que consideramos que es el debe, ¿no? de un profesor, ¿no? Que por supuesto, en muchos casos, yo veo mi universidad y en muchos casos ya me gustaría que todo nuestro profesorado cumpliese con ese estándar de aseguramiento, ¿no? Para hacerlo. Pero existe un segundo nivel, que es un salto cualitativo muy grande, ¿no? Que es, todos los saltos son muy grandes, ¿no? Como verán, que es un profesor de buena calidad, ¿no? Un buen profesor o una buena profesora, ¿no? Y básicamente lo que lo caracteriza es que tiene no solamente un buen conocimiento de su disciplina, algo imprescindible, por supuesto, sino que tiene un conocimiento suficiente de lo que llamamos buenas prácticas en educación superior. Eso significa aprendizaje activo, colaborativo, pone en marcha en sus aulas ese tipo de cuestiones y, por supuesto, practica una reflexión sobre su propia docencia, pues a partir de las encuestas de los estudiantes, a partir de lo que sus estudiantes elaboran, genera ese trabajo reflexivo. Por supuesto, este es un profesor que planifica pensando en las competencias de sus estudiantes de una manera coordinada con el resto de su titulación. Su evaluación ya no es solo transparente, sino que tiene unos niveles de fiabilidad y validez adecuados, ¿no? Y, por supuesto, es un profesor que participa en este tipo de eventos, participa regularmente en proyectos de innovación, tiene una cierta presencia en esos procesos de mejora, ¿no? Frente a esta idea de este buen profesor, si lo piensan, es más o menos la idea que hemos promocionado desde nuestros ICES, es la formación que hemos hecho. Estamos aquí exactamente promocionando, así que estamos permanentemente pasando entre el primer y segundo escalón. Yo creo que esa es nuestra situación actual, ¿no? Pero creo que es bueno que establezcamos más niveles. ¿Dónde está el horizonte siguiente, ¿no? ¿Dónde deberíamos? Eso afecta a nuestra formación, afecta a cómo planificamos nuestro desarrollo docente. Creo que existe un nivel de excelencia que marca una diferencia bastante grande. Es aquel docente que se está basando ya en la investigación sobre el aprendizaje de su propia materia, que conoce a fondo toda la investigación, es realmente un estudioso de la, de su profesión, de la educación superior, particularmente su disciplina, obviamente, como no puede ser de otro modo. Así que tiene una formación muy, muy sólida, ¿no? A partir de allí, por supuesto, pone en marcha procesos de diagnóstico de su propia docencia profundos. Eso significa no circunscribirse a las opiniones que vienen en las encuestas de nuestros estudiantes, eso significa de verdad poner en marcha procesos de focus group, etcétera, con los cuales con tus estudiantes acabas teniendo una idea muy, muy clara de cuál es la experiencia de tus estudiantes en tu curso, ¿no? ¿Cómo funciona tu curso realmente y cuáles son los espacios de mejora que tienes, los retos que plantea tu propio curso, etcétera, etcétera? Es decir, el nivel de reflexividad es realmente mucho más alto, ¿no? En el planteamiento docente ya no se trata simplemente de tener metodologías activas y colaborativas, de lo que se trata es, por supuesto, de incorporar ideas muy, muy importantes como altos niveles de implicación, cómo hacemos para tener altos niveles de implicación de los estudiantes, cómo hacemos para orientarlos al aprendizaje profundo, algo que está íntimamente ligado al desarrollo de competencias de alto nivel, ¿no? Por supuesto, ya no estamos hablando de evaluación válida y fiable, estamos hablando de evaluación para el aprendizaje, evaluación diseñada para potenciar específicamente el aprendizaje, y este profesor excelente, claro, tiene una presencia habitual en los foros, porque esa idea de scholarship of teaching and learning que nos dejó, que se ha ido desarrollando a partir de Boyer, está implícita la idea de que no solo indagamos sobre nuestra docencia, sino que comunicamos, debatimos con nuestros pares lo que estamos haciendo. Ser académico en la docencia significa esto. Significa no solamente ser rigurosos en la toma de datos sobre lo que estamos haciendo, sino también el comunicarlo con nuestros pares, ¿no? Así que es un modelo de profesor muchísimo más extraño. Todos conocemos algún caso que funciona así, pero es un nivel de profesor muchísimo más extraño. Y, por supuesto, podríamos pensar en el premio Nobel. El premio Nobel de la docencia, ¿no? ¿Dónde está ese ideal absoluto que tendríamos allí, ¿no? Y ese ideal en el que, desde mi punto de vista, nosotros siempre debatimos mucho si es bueno colocar este nivel en un marco o si con ello lo que vamos a hacer es ahuyentar a todo el mundo, ¿no? No lo sé, ¿no? A mí siempre me parece que es bueno saber dónde está el premio Nobel, ¿no? Para saber hacia dónde camina alguien, ¿no? Para hacerlo, aunque por muy lejano que esté, ¿no? Y lo cierto es que es un profesor, claro, donde es que su docencia es un espacio de investigación. Y al ser un espacio de investigación, concurren allí terceras personas. Tengo permanentemente terceras personas metidas en el aula haciendo peer review o tengo terceras personas evaluando los resultados de aprendizaje, las realizaciones de mis estudiantes. Por supuesto, publico los resultados con un cierto índice de impacto, ¿no?, sobre mis resultados académicos. Es decir, estamos hablando de un auténtico profesional que hace de la docencia su auténtico centro de trabajo. Por supuesto, lo que ofrece a los estudiantes son eso que llamamos para los estudiantes experiencias memorables, esas que le cambian a uno, ¿no? Realmente, eso es lo que ofrece a los estudiantes, ¿no? Algo tan que todos, si hemos tenido suerte, solamente si hemos tenido suerte, hemos vivido alguna vez, ¿no? De esos profesores que te cambian tu manera de ver las cosas, ¿no? Eso es este premio Nobel, ¿no? Para hacerlo. Así que simplemente apuntar, ¿no? Para que veamos que esto tiene mucho recorrido y claro que hay niveles de calidad distintos, ¿no? Y estamos trabajando en los niveles más bajos. Es bueno tener la visión de que existe un desarrollo docente, de que existe una carrera docente. Esa visión de lo que significa una carrera docente, si lo piensan, no es muy diferente a lo que pensamos en una carrera investigadora. Claro que en la carrera investigadora podemos pensar en ese último nivel, ¿no? Que nos resulta muy, muy lejano. Y lo tenemos en la mente. ¿Por qué no tener en la mente ese último nivel de lo que significa una carrera docente? Pero tenemos que trabajar para configurar esa representación compartida para hacerlo, ¿no? Yo lo que creo es que, el trabajo que se puede hacer es simplemente por criterios donde vamos delineando los diferentes escalones, ¿no? Si lo piensan, por ejemplo, por coger un criterio muy, muy sencillo, ¿no? Entre la opacidad de objetivos, la alienación del estudiante, es decir, esa idea de estudio lo que me van pidiendo, no sé bien para qué o por qué sí, hasta el último nivel, que es la apropiación de los objetivos y el programa de trabajo por parte de los estudiantes, ¿no? Claro, está el que simplemente publica su programa de trabajo, está el que debate, trabaja la explicación detallada con los estudiantes del por qué y el para qué de todo su currículo y los perfiles y le dedica tiempo dentro de su programa a que los estudiantes entiendan la relevancia de lo que está haciendo, o está los que ponen en marcha actividades específicas para entender la relevancia. Recuerdo un estudio de David Kember sobre esto que era particularmente valioso, ¿no? Por ejemplo, pues cuando te traes a profesionales de tu ámbito de trabajo y de ese modo ellos les explican del modo en que utilizan la materia y toda esa la relevancia percibida por parte de los estudiantes de aquello que van a trabajar es muy muy importante, y por supuesto la idea en que debatir con ellos, la idea en que el programa del curso contribuye al logro de esos objetivos. Así podríamos ir pensando en qué significan los diferentes escalones, los diferentes criterios, ¿no? Simplemente este, ¿no? Es una dimensión que es la docencia basada en la tradición, en la imitación, en la intuición, mientras la idea de la docencia basada en la investigación sobre la propia docencia, ¿no? En un primer nivel, ese nivel de aseguramiento estaría simplemente que tiene en cuenta los resultados de las encuestas de sus estudiantes para detectar los problemas que puede haber y corregirlos, ¿no? Ese es un nivel muy, muy básico, ¿no? Tenemos ya ese nivel de buen profesor o buena profesora en el que ya analiza con detalle las opiniones de sus estudiantes, las realizaciones de sus estudiantes y saca conclusiones detalladas sobre las fortalezas, las debilidades, los retos del curso, es decir, tiene una actividad mucho... Y por otro lado tenemos ya quien de verdad empieza a indagar en su docencia, ¿no? Y utiliza otras herramientas para inspeccionar la experiencia de los estudiantes en sus cursos, analiza con detalle los resultados de aprendizaje, identifica las dificultades, etcétera, etcétera. Y por último, por supuesto, tenemos ya el que su planificación docente es en realidad una hipótesis, ¿no? Y realmente una hipótesis en un sentido fuerte, ¿no? De investigación. Es toda esa idea de concebir nuestra planificación como una hipótesis, que es una idea antigua, ¿no? De Lawrence Stenhouse, ¿no? Y que a mí me parece increíblemente atractiva, ¿no? Toda nuestra planificación es una hipótesis, ¿no? Una hipótesis que intentamos confirmar y que, por supuesto, sometemos de forma rigurosa a inspección por pares, por expertos externos, etcétera, etcétera, ¿no? Todo es esta visión de un desarrollo continuo, es un poco lo que se ha intentado con otros marcos. La propuesta, la idea que quería traerles es, ¿no deberíamos empezar a trabajar en esta idea? ¿No deberíamos empezar a debatir qué es lo que significa para nosotros? Sea cual sea el resultado, debemos tener una representación compartida de lo que significa para nosotros, o si no, en esa especie de escenario plano de lo que es ser buen profesor o ser buena profesora, en realidad vamos a pocos sitios, porque vemos que la evaluación se traslada a esa visión, vemos cómo todo el reconocimiento se traslada a esa visión, se hace acorde con esa visión, vemos cómo todos los procesos de calidad de mejora se ahorman a esa visión. Así que yo creo que simplemente hablando con compañeros del sistema británico, ¿no? Yo me acuerdo con Joe Pitt o con James Wisdom, ¿no? Cuando decíamos, ellos decían, del trabajo de elaboración del UKPSF, que ha sido lo más interesante, la mayor aportación. Ellos siempre decían, la mayor interesante fue el debate, que duró tiempo, entre toda la gente de las universidades, pensando colectivamente que cómo debía ser ese marco, ¿no? Yo creo que es una gran lección, ¿no? El debate en sí mismo produce un efecto muy, muy importante sobre eso. Es decir, yo creo que el debate sobre dónde están los umbrales, qué significa ser un profesor y que empecemos a divertir, es lo que de verdad va a contribuir al reconocimiento y la valoración de la docencia como actividad universitaria, ¿no? Por supuesto, tener un marco de ese tipo es lo que configura, y de hecho así lo ha hecho, lo que configura los planes, los programas de desarrollo profesional internos de las propias universidades. Y por supuesto, claro, esos marcos, y este es el aspecto siempre más complicado, es referente de los sistemas de evaluación. De hecho, en Reino Unido ocurre así, ¿no? Es el referente de los sistemas de evaluación y reconocimiento del profesorado, un reconocimiento interuniversitario de lo que es el profesorado, ¿no? Así que yo creo que necesitamos construir esta visión más compleja, más basada en la investigación, sobre lo que significa. Necesitamos que esa sea una representación compartida si queremos que realmente deje de ser, la docencia deje de ser esa actividad poco cualificada que hacemos los profesores universitarios frente a esa actividad muy cualificada que es la investigación. Yo creo que necesitamos dar ese paso y esta era un poco la propuesta que quería lanzarles y espero que pueda resultarles interesante. Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias, profesor Paricio. Y si os sembla, sense més, donem pas a la segona presentació, a la segona ponència d'aquest matí, i després esperem tenir una bona estona pel debat i les preguntes amb tots vosaltres. Presento, mentre el professor es posa el micròfon. Sí. Ok. Presento al professor Paul Blackmore. Ell és... He's Professor of Higher Education at the Policy Institute at the King's College London. He has led academic development and research centers at the universities of Warwick, Coventry and King's, all of them in UK. And he has written and published several books. I just mentioned some of them. Strategic Curriculum Change in Universities, Global Trends, Prestige in Academic Life, Excellence and Exclusion, Exploring Difference and Motivation in Academic Life, and the Role of Prestige in UK Universities by Chancellor's Perspectives. He has also was awarded with the National Teaching Fellowship. So thank you very much for being with us here in Barcelona, in Catalonia. You will have a variety of universities. All universities from Catalonia are represented here, and we are very willing to learn from you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much indeed. And good morning, everybody. And I do apologize for speaking in English today. That is my only option. I wish I could do otherwise. Let me just check that this is working. That's good. I gave a talk the other month using one of these, and I couldn't get it to work at all. And I was getting quite embarrassed. And then a member of the audience shouted out, "You've got it upside down," and I had, and I just turned it the other way up and it worked perfectly. That's a form of professional development, if ever there was one. Now, I like to start with this one because my view is you judge the message by where you think the messenger is coming from, as it were. And the reason I'm interested in this and the reason I wrote a book on curriculum change and a book on prestige is that I've worked in universities since I think about 1823, but that's seriously quite a long time now. And I've worked in research-intensive universities and teaching-led ones. I've worked as an academic, I've worked as an administrator, I've actually worked in a school and a college and so on. And in that time, one of the things that has interested me is how difficult it is to achieve change. And most of that time, I've been trying to help improve the quality of teaching, and it's not necessarily all that easy. I think Javier's really interesting talked about the UK system. That has been a 30-year journey to get to that point, and it's not been a wholly successful journey. It's not easy, what we are looking at here. So what I would like to talk about today is something about the failure rate of educational initiatives. Then a little bit about prestige in universities, and bring that to bear on the research and teaching divide as I and a number of other people would see it in universities. And then say a little bit about learning, which might perhaps unite those two things. So in some ways, to connect my talk up with the one that came before, that was a very neat and really interesting set of steps. Two questions come to my mind. One is, how do you get people to go up those steps? And two, that immediately problematizes the nature of those steps and where they're heading. So I think that's a really interesting opener and preparation for what I'm trying to say now. What I'm trying to do is say it's tricky and there are ways through it. Okay, and here are my list of recurring problems, enduring problems in universities. I think I recognize this, that over many years, you can see that we try to do some things, this whole bunch of things here, and it's quite difficult to get any progress. And the first one there, I think, that research is more highly valued than teaching at the cost of teaching, has been a feature of my professional life for very many years, and you puzzle over how to change that, really. And just to visually present it here, slightly smudgy, but a presentation of a medieval classroom, and notice how far we have come in 600 years. You know, somebody walking into this room from 1400 would immediately recognize what was going on here, I think. Now, there are obviously good reasons why things don't change, but there are also bad reasons for things not changing. And in the case of large lectures, we know they have some good uses, but we know they're hugely overused in universities and used for jobs that they are not very good at. And yet we continue to overuse lectures. It's a good and obvious example of change. And if we look at how we're trying to achieve change at the moment, we're doing it in two ways, I think. One is by being more specific about what we want in terms of student performance and academic performance, and another is by shouting at people and publicly embarrassing them with league tables that say they're not doing as well as someone else. And that is a way of trying to achieve change, but it's only, I suggest, fitfully successful, really. And I just call in aid Francis Cornford, who wrote a really interesting book about educational change. The whole of it is on the web. It's only about 100 pages long. And he makes this point. Essentially, don't appeal only to reason, because you can spend so long persuading people to agree that the time to do whatever you wanted to do will have passed. Now, he says, address your arguments to prejudice and the political motive. I'm not sure I'm quite as cynical as that, but I do think there's a whole lot of being human, if you like, that we don't think about when we think about educational change. And so my basic questions would be, do we actually know enough about people who work in higher education and what motivates them? And when we try to make policy changes, do we take sufficient notice of where they're coming from and who they think they are and what they think their purpose is? My argument obviously is no. You can see I'm setting it up that way. And so I just offer you another visual image of an educational initiative. I have seen many of them in 30 years, all geared to producing higher prestige for teaching. And this is what happened to every one of them pretty well. Now, my explanation for it, and I want to spend just a few minutes on it, is that there is an iceberg out there for educational initiatives that strive to improve the perception of teaching. And that is the iceberg of prestige. And prestige, like an iceberg, is largely hidden. We often pretend we're not doing things for prestige reasons. I am doing things because it's right. That other person is doing them for prestige reasons. It's something we tend to criticize in others whilst doing it ourselves. And interestingly, the Latin derivation of it says something about how awkward we are about prestige, because prestigium means a delusion or a trick. So there's something we don't quite like about prestige, although we are aware of it all the time and we practice prestige all the time. Now, let me just try to say a few things that really hammer home how central this is to universities. And then I'm going to try and define prestige and separate it from reputation. Well, that's a fairly obvious, if smudgy, picture of academic prestige. We're all used to academic gowns and so on. That's a very obvious sort of external prediction of prestige. There are some slightly less obvious ones. This is my favorite picture of the moment. It's a building that my own institution has taken over in London. It's Bush House. And it's a wonderful example of prestige at work in a couple of ways. First of all, you can just about see that it has ancient Greek columns, which were constructed in 1926 when the building went up in order to make it look like a really old building. And secondly, in the front of it, there is a large open space. Now that in a city where land costs about €1 billion a square meter. But it's a big open space in which you cannot teach and you cannot research and you cannot do administration. It is used mainly by pigeons. But it has a prestige value. As you know, prestige is a signaling business. You can signal that you have wealth. You can signal that you are generous with space. And that's the job it does. The prestige is there in all sorts of places. And at the moment, probably the biggest prestige story is that of global league tables. As we know, we are obsessed with league tables. And in some ways, we can't help but be obsessed with them because they are so public and so well publicized. And there are several well-regarded, as we know, systems of judging the quality of universities, which are largely prestige measures, as I'll attempt to show in a minute. They have not a lot to do with reputation. They are mostly to do with prestige. EU Multirank is a lesser known one, the EU sponsored one that tries to break with the idea of prestige and say, let's judge universities on whatever criterion you want, not whether it's like Harvard or not, which is what the majority of global league tables are doing. Okay, let me try to get to a definition, which I think is an interesting one. It's not mine. Originally, it's from three US econometricians who tried to look at what universities were trying to do and to place values on them, financial values on them. And they proposed that there are two different ways of gaining status. One is through prestige and the other is through reputation. And to give you an obvious example, a Nobel Prize at the top there is a prestige issue because there's a limited number of them. It's great when you get one. Your institution is delighted when you get one because you've got it and others haven't, but you don't actually know the value of it in financial terms. If you then take something like assessing your students and handing their work back within 3 weeks, which is a target that many UK universities try to reach, that's a reputation issue because it doesn't bring you prestige. Principally, everybody can do it if they try, so it can't be a prestige issue. And it's something that is not particularly wanted by the insiders in education. It's an outsider or a stakeholder pressure. And so you've got that proposed difference between prestige and reputation, that on the prestige side, it's measured relative to others. It's a league table issue. Only a few people can have it by definition. It tends to be defined by us, and it arrives slowly and it goes slowly. It's a rival good, it's not a non-rival good. And the argument that a number of people have made is that research is a prestige-generating activity and teaching is a reputation-generating activity, that almost by definition, you can't get to be prestigious as a result of doing teaching. Now, before you protest any kind of model that separates the world into two parts, is of course open to contestation, I agree. But I think there's enough here to be worth looking at it, and it might help to explain a little bit about why things don't change. Here, I probably won't be able to show you much of this, but here are, because it looks smudgy from here, but here are two UK universities setting out their stall very differently. Teesside University is a teaching-led institution. It does a very, very valuable job in Middlesbrough, where it is centred. And that picture up there, all different, all equal, is a very, very inclusive message. That is a reputation message. Durham University, you may just about be able to see the bowed heads, the academic gowns, the cathedral in the distance. That, if anything, is a prestige pitch, isn't it, I think. So by just looking at two ways in which universities present themselves, you can see these two things going on. Others have written about prestige in an interesting way in talking about an economy of prestige. That is a space where there are people who all have roughly the same values and who generate things that they recognize among one another. James English wrote a very interesting book about literary prizes. There is one now every week, pretty well. And he asked, well, who is generating this prestige? How is it understood? How is it traded? And so on, with what effects? And he asks, I think, a central question about prestige in society. How is it produced? Where does it reside? Is it in people and in things, or is it in the relationship between people and things? And, well, the answer is the last one. Clearly, it's in the relationship between people and things. You know, a block of gold on a desert island is of no particular value until there are people there and one person has that block of gold, then it becomes a prestige issue. So if we now look at academia and we try to take that idea and put it into academia, here's a very, very simple example. What are our prestige items? Well, in academia, these are the things that tend to fill up our curriculum vitae. They're not actually directly related to money. That's an interesting factor of academic life. As we know, if you're an active researcher, you will know that if you get money from one source, it can be much more valuable than much more money coming from a different source. It's the nature of the source that makes a difference. If it's a prestigious source, then the money is worth more. So what we have here is classically, people who are interested in this will have been saying for the last 5 minutes, this is Bourdieu, isn't it? But yes, Bourdieu has written extensively over many years about this, about the notion of capital in specifically academic life, and not just economic capital, but cultural and social capital. The symbols we're associated with, the people we know, and so on, are forms of capital that lead to prestige. And if we are trying to understand the prestige economy, then we have to look at where the boundary is. I mean, what is this economy? Who is in it? What constitutes the boundary? What does it cohere around? What do people tend to believe and value? What do they generate and trade? And so on. And it's not just boundaries, but there are also brokers, and this is a rather satirical notion of a broker, a manipulator of people and information who brings about communication for profit. So in the UK, I would have said the Times Higher magazine is a really good example of a broker in that it produces a league table just about every week, and there's one sure beneficiary of that, of all of those tables, and that is the Times Higher. Now I want to just use a couple of slides which may seem like an aside, but I think they're really important, and they make the point about prestige being a hidden item. And that is that quite often we do things for prestige reasons and we don't know that we do necessarily, or we conceal it from ourselves. And Matthew, I think, Lieberman wrote a very interesting book several years ago. He's not the first to make the point, but he made the point that human beings like to pretend we're all individuals. We like to think we've all come to our own view, but in fact, we spend most of our time carefully monitoring what everybody else does and thinks, and we don't often really step out of line. If we do step out of line, we find ourselves living in a lonely cave somewhere, generally speaking, either professionally or actually. And so we actually are quite reluctant to go away from the dominant norm. And there are obvious benefits for that, that he and others have identified, that if you can all, even if it's subconsciously, agree what is of the highest valuation, you don't have to think about it anymore. You don't have to argue about it anymore. It produces a simple and stable world. And it also produces the opportunity to be competitive. So there are reasons why we actually buy into prestige and we're not even aware that we're doing it. Now let's turn that issue to, and bring it to bear on academic life. Now, one of my starting points here would be the centrality of disciplines. Now, a lot of people now are arguing that disciplines are of no importance in academic life anymore. We're post-discipline and so on. Well, I have yet to meet a physicist who didn't know he or she was a physicist. You know, we're pretty clear, actually, despite the rhetoric being that disciplines don't matter much anymore. They still do, because universities produce knowledge that is largely defined in terms of disciplines, and people are socially organized in terms of disciplines and are rewarded for their excellence within their discipline. And so it's not exactly something that we can disregard, which has a bearing when we start to think about how you try to get somebody enthusiastic about teaching. And one of the ways we understand our place in the world and our place in the discipline is that we all know the story that we need to have happen in our life if we are to do well. I'll just give you a second to have a look at that so that I don't read it to you. Now, if we had more time, we could have a discussion at this point, but I would guess that everybody here knows how to get on in their discipline. You know the story, you know the things you have to achieve, as this political scientist does. And the trouble with it is that the story doesn't usually include excellent teaching, as it doesn't there, really. So we've got a problem. So we've got prestige happening, just to complicate matters further. Remember, Foucault, I think, was asked what an academic is for, and his answer was to complicate matters. So I'm complicating it here. Prestige may be different at different levels. If you're trying to construct prestige economies, they can occur in all sorts of different places. But very powerful prestige economies are in the department, in the research and teaching group, and in the discipline, how people are actually socialized. And the discipline, interestingly, transcends or goes beyond the institution. So, let's come back to this issue of why we don't... I think I've just missed a slide. Let me just check if I've missed... No, I haven't. No, we're onto the right slide. So, why do we have problems with getting certain things valued? Now, here's another take on it, which I think is relevant to this, that we value different kinds of knowledge more highly than others. This is borrowed from Donald Schoen's very famous book, The Reflective Practitioner, 1970-something, but still valuable, I think, in which he argues that culturally we value at the top basic science much more than we value applied science. And we value, least of all, actually doing something useful with people. And this, he argues, has been running through universities and Western life in general forever, virtually. And that, again, plays into the notion of prestige. Well, what should you be putting your time into if you wish to be prestigious? It is pretty obvious you need to be at the top end of things there. And if you then look, as he does, at different professions and academic groupings, he separates out two categories, those who have what he calls hard knowledge and those that he calls soft knowledge. And by hard knowledge, propositional knowledge, knowledge that is held to be universally true wherever it is to be found. And his argument, which is shot through with problems, I think, before anybody else says anything, is that you have hard knowledge areas and soft knowledge areas. And in the opening chapter of his book, which I heartily recommend to read, he argues that you get into the university and you get on in the university, if you're on that right-hand side, by borrowing the clothes of the people on the left-hand side. That is, you generate as much hard knowledge as you possibly can, even if it's largely irrelevant to the practice that you are talking about. So there again, we can see where prestige is to be found. I point out a major problem with this. I mean, he argues that the left-hand side is what has formed the university, but divinity is on the right-hand side. So that's clearly wrong. Now, if I come back to this, why is the person standing behind the lectern, as I am now, professing? And what do they think they're professing? So much easier to profess physics, hard knowledge, high status, research-based, what their upbringing has brought them to. How much harder to say, I'm there because I teach soft knowledge, low prestige. Why would I want to be associated with that? And my principal argument here really is, if that is the case, and I think it is, then the more you separate research and teaching, the more you make sure that research carries on having high prestige and teaching has low prestige. It is sadly inevitable. Now let's look at the nature of teaching. So I'm just keeping an eye on the time. One of the problems I think we have with teaching is that it's been taken off into a corner somewhere. And it now has a language which most people don't speak. Even if you're an English speaker, you don't use these words very much. We now talk very much about learning outcomes. We talk about constructive alignment, whether what we're trying to do is in line with what we're doing, with what we assess and how we evaluate and so on. And we talk about student satisfaction. And one of the problems, I think, with becoming more technical, as we are, about teaching, for very good reasons sometimes, because ignorance in teaching is not commendable either, one of the problems is that people say, oh, fine, that's what people over there do. That's what the teaching enthusiasts do. Just leave me alone to get on with what I do. The language doesn't reach out to people. And so we have a problem here, I think. This is constructive alignment. This is now the dominant paradigm in higher education, what I was describing just now, that you set up an environment having been very clear at the start what you're trying to teach, then you teach it in the right way, then you assess it in the correct way, and you have done your job. And at the heart of it, as some people have commented, is a central problem that it begins with the idea that everything is known, and another idea, which is I know it and you don't, and I'm going to pass it on to you. It's a transmission model of teaching, inescapably, at the end of it. That's not to say that we shouldn't have learning outcomes. That's not to say that these things shouldn't be in alignment. It's just that dangers come with that approach to things, because it turns teaching into a set of techniques and it ties everything down into things that have been predicted in advance. And I would just bring a challenge in from a very long time ago. This is the very famous Carl Rogers, who wrote in the 60s, 70s, and this was revised in the 90s, about student-centeredness. And his argument, well, I'll give you a second to read that. His argument from a long time ago is, if we take all the responsibility for learning and we define what is to be learned and we do all the assessing and so on, we choose what it is that people are going to do, then, as he says, meaningful learning will be at an absolute minimum. Well, that raises the question of what we mean by meaningful learning, of course, because one person's meaning may not be another person's meaning. Well, and that indeed is the point, in a sense. But I think it's an interesting challenge that the more we become technical and exact about teaching, the more we adopt a specialist vocabulary, the more we speak in general terms about teaching, the harder it is to hook people in who see themselves mainly as researchers. So, let me come to the end of this part of what I'm going to say with some conclusions about prestige. First of all, prestige is absolutely central to understanding a university life, in my view, and ignoring it doesn't make it go away. Reaching for the megaphone and saying even more clearly what it is that you want people to do doesn't work. It'll never work. The iceberg is always there. So prestige always, I would argue, beats reputation. It's more exciting. It's more frothy. It garners you more praise. And it can be a powerful force for good as well as bad. There's no point in saying we will ban prestige from the world. We are hardwired for it. We can't ban prestige. We've just got to understand it and how it works and not pretend that it doesn't work. It directs career pathways, and it influences very much the nature of outputs. And interestingly, you could take something that the UK government has done recently in research as an example of how you can change prestige rules. You may or may not know that in the UK we have a research assessment exercise, a national exercise that occurs every 5 or 6 years. And most recently, the Research Excellence Framework, the REF, most recent example, introduced impact into the judgments made about the quality of research. For the first time, all academics were faced with the question, so what? What did your research do in the real world? Well, everybody jumped up and down and squealed and got cross and then set to start to demonstrate the impact that they felt that their research was having. And some very creative minds were revealed as a result of that. But it's a good example of how if you get to the heart of what it is that people really value and change the rules a bit, you might actually get somewhere rather than starting somewhere else altogether and saying, would you like to come over here and have a go at teaching? So what else have we got there? Yes, the other dangers then of prestige are that prestige does maintain hierarchies and traditions. It encourages tribalism, it limits innovation. But the optimistic thing, as I said with the REF, prestige engineering does work. It can work. Let me just sort of say a couple of things about one or two of the things that have been happening in the UK, just as examples of how well-meaning things can go wrong. The UK government is very keen on high-quality teaching. It is a very, very strong driver from government at the moment. And by that, much of what they mean by that is knowing what it is that students have learned and knowing that they are employable. Employability is a major, major issue. And they say teaching has been the poor cousin of research. There have been skewed incentives. So there's been a progressive decline in the relative status of teaching as an activity. Then, this was from the Green Paper, which was a consultation paper, we will act, as they have, to ensure teaching and research remain coherent and coordinated at the national as well as at the institutional level. Right, well, that sounds good. That sounds as if they've really got to the heart of the problem. They want to coordinate teaching and research very well. So what has the UK government done? Set up two different government departments, one of them dealing with students and the other dealing with research. And where there used to be an overlap, because the English Funding Council used to deal both with funding for teaching and research, it's been separated. So now we have two totally different bodies, one pushing teaching and one pushing research. I did ask a minister who was involved in that why they hadn't thought about having the whole thing under one roof. And he said, well, we thought about it briefly when we thought it would be rather complicated, so we didn't do it. Yeah, it would have been complicated, but it would might mean that the two would have some relationship. That picture, by the way, is Joe Johnson, who is a responsible in government for both of those departments at the moment. That doesn't make me any more optimistic. And then another thing that government is very strong on at the moment is the National Student Survey, which is issued to all students who are leaving their undergraduate degree. And it asks them questions about the quality of their teaching. Now, the problem with those things that they are asked about is it is based on the hotel notion of a university. How many books were available? How comfortable did you feel? Were you happy? Were you satisfied? It doesn't really ask anything about what the student brought to it or how the student changed as a result. It's really just asking about education as a service. So the big signal that is given by the government into the sector is that it is about making students happy by providing things for them. It's a particular model of what education is about, and it means students' role is to be passive consumers or customers. And of course, in some ways, they are. They are now in the UK when they pay something like 10,000 euros a year for their undergraduate degree. But in other ways, they can't ever be customers. It's a very foolish metaphor, and yet it's the way university quality is being measured. It's the most important driver in the UK for universities to respond to. Okay, let me now, just keeping an eye on the time as well, bring this round to the real focus of what I want to talk about here, which is the relationship between research and teaching. And the argument I want to advance here is the pretty obvious one, I think, really, especially in the light of what I'm saying, is that if you try to produce a professional framework that is about teaching only and about a particular way of viewing teaching, which is quite a technical way of viewing teaching, then you are unlikely to engage the full interest of the academic body that you have to persuade. And they have to be persuaded. They really do. So let me move on to the relationship between research and teaching. Now, one of the interesting things about that is that many people in research-led institutions will say, of course, there is a strong relationship between the quality of research and the quality of teaching. It's a basic belief that runs through many people's minds. Of course, if you've got excellent research, you're going to get excellent teaching. It's bound to be the case. Look at Oxford. Everybody wants to go there. That's because they've got excellent research, and so on and so on. Well, two quotes which I think are quite interesting. The first was from a very influential report. That's now a very old one. It's sometimes called the Boyer Report into universities in the US. This is nearly 20 years ago. The whole of the Boyer Report is on the web and very interesting reading. And essentially what they say is that if universities were second-hand car salesmen, they would be in jail because they're promising one thing but actually giving another, that students are not actually gaining access to the research strengths of the institution. They think they're going to see the professors, but they see a poorly trained graduate teaching assistant until their final year, and so on and so on. And that made quite a difference in the US, given that it's a very stratified and competitive system and degrees cost a lot. To claim that what people were buying was not really worth a great deal was quite an important thing to say. The second quote is from an external evaluation of a UK university, and it's a very common thing. I think you could say it of a lot of universities. The precise relationship of the link seems not to have been addressed in any concerted way. little systematic reflection within the university about what was meant by the claimed interdependence of teaching and research. So a lot of rhetoric about how teaching and research are interconnected, but actually when you dig a little bit, you find that it's not. And the unfortunate, and I think it's fair to say this is a fact, and certainly not an alternative fact, is Hattie and Marsh, who some years ago, two New Zealand academics, did a meta-study of studies. They did a study of the studies that tried to show what is the relationship between high-quality research and high-quality teaching. How does it feed through? And the answer that they came up with as a result of this big study of studies, is there isn't a relationship between the quality of research, the quality of teaching. Just because the research is good does not mean that the teaching is good, or indeed of any particular kind. They're two rather independent things, particularly in the natural sciences, particularly in research-intensive universities. Interestingly, they're the people who usually shout loudest about how their research is feeding into their teaching, but there doesn't seem to be evidence that it makes any difference or that it actually happens. Where it does happen a little more is in liberal arts colleges. You can see a number of these studies are on a US base, therefore, and in the social sciences. But even there's not much of a relationship. So we've got an undeveloped relationship in universities, but potentially a really important one, provided the two are brought together much more. And I think this is perhaps a more interesting way of starting to think about research and teaching. Why do we continue to think of them as different things? You can argue they are the same thing, really. This is a couple of quotes coming from very different registers, I think, but making the same point that it's about learning, it's about enthusiasm. The whole thing is about that. And unless we focus on that, we end up with two very separate ways of viewing the world. There is the way we think and act as researchers and the way we teach our students. And the two are very different. And it's not surprising that researchers aren't that interested sometimes in teaching. That's a huge generalization. If the teaching itself is not of interest, is not intellectually challenging to them, is not using their best intellect, as it were, and also if it isn't tailored to their discipline, the needs of their discipline. Okay, I've just got a couple of quotes from a study that I did some years ago of the connection between research and teaching as it happens in a university. I asked some very senior researchers and I asked some students what they thought the relationship was between research and teaching, and I just offer you two just to show how varied it is. There's very positive ones. Great to know you're being taught by people who are well respected in their field. Good that you can know up-to-date stuff. Cool seeing articles and stuff written by people in the department. Very cheerful, very en song. Then I got an awful lot that was really rather like this. And I don't know if this works in Spain, but for a UK audience, everybody can point out a man, it generally is a man, who is theoretically here, but actually isn't, especially when there is practical work to be done. And so that illustrates, if you like, one of the problems that research can take people away from teaching. That is a danger. Now, the benefits of bringing research and teaching together are well known. This is not new stuff. I know you know this. I'm trying to put it together into an argument about teacher professionalisation. The benefits are huge from starting to construct your teaching in a research-like way. It's motivating for students. We know that activity in learning, if it's done well, gets people far more engaged. And it's an opportunity to develop all sorts of skills, and that links with the employability issue. What can students actually do at the end of it. It's not just what they know, it's what they can do. So the potential benefits of bringing research and teaching together are immense. And I want to argue that as far as teacher professionalization is concerned, the same medicine applies. Now, where are we with the academy now? If we look at what's happening across the world, I think in most countries, the former, if like the tripartite role that academics used to teach and research and be administrators is falling apart. Forgive me for that. That more and more people are being appointed on teaching-only contracts or research-only contracts. So, in many universities, the number of academic staff who do all of those things is less than half, and it's falling. In the UK, it's 48% at the moment, and falling. So this traditional idea of the rounded academic is becoming much less true than it was. Well, what do we do in the face of that? Do we just let it fall apart? Or do we try to think of some intelligent way of stitching all those things together so that they're all part of the same thing? And my potential answer at the bottom is, complex learning and its development is presumably something that unites all of those things. And the sooner we think of ourselves as being experts in that, the better. Sadly, what is meant by complex learning and the skills to encourage it are not as widespread as they should be in institutions. I think it's a real challenge. But that surely is what we should be good at. And that, I suggest, is what you can build a professional framework around. Tying it back with what was said many years ago, I think this is quite useful. Those of you who are involved in teacher education will know this. You know, these are very well-known frameworks. Ernest Boyer, I think, made a real contribution to the world in saying, let's not just think about research and teaching and separate them out, because it's making certain assumptions about what research is and what teaching is. And it's usually going to the far end of each of them and then saying, aren't they different? Well, his suggestion is that we should think instead of four scholarships. Sure, at the one end is discovery learning, basic research. And at the other end is pretty straightforward teaching and learning, although we have to think about what we mean by that. But in between, there is research that integrates existing knowledge. There is research that applies knowledge to real life situations. And all of those have to be driven by scholarship. Now, the nice thing about that really quite old now framework is that it makes problematic what it is to be a researcher and what it is to be a teacher, and puts them all on a continuum. That, I think, is a much better way of viewing it than starting off saying, well, there's research and then there's teaching, because quite often you have accepted a very, I think, old-fashioned and inappropriate view about what research is and what teaching is. So those terms need to be rethought. Coming slowly to the end of what I'm going to say, let me just throw in some other little changes, because in talking about research and teaching, there's a danger of thinking it's just something we talk about within the university. But the world is moving on quite significantly. I can only just signal at the moment all of the issues that come up in a globalized world with staff flow, student flow, flow of knowledge, the much freer flow of everything that we deal with in universities, and of communications networks. We have only just begun to think through what that means and where universities are placed in amongst this. But if we then, just to bring the two images together, we have a radically different world now than we used to have. We no longer generate, if we ever did, most of the knowledge in the world. The world's busy out there inventing it for itself, and there are many private organizations and so on that are doing research-like activities or research activities. We don't hold the corner on that anymore. And what is seen as valuable research is now much broader than it was. And all of the knowledge in the world, pretty well, is available to anybody who's got access to the internet. That's staggeringly important in terms of thinking, well, what's a university for? And I come back again to the notion that it's about complex learning and its development then, because surely that's what we know about, or can be what we know about, and it can be constructed at the intersection between research and teaching. Two last slides, I think. What practically can be done here? Well, here's a set of questions that I've used quite frequently in looking at university practice and going into departments and trying to encourage people to think about the relationship between research and teaching. And I think those are quite useful questions. I'm always amused by how the students come into contact with the department's research, because I went round some very posh universities indeed and asked the students how they knew that their university was a research-intensive university, and a number of them said, oh, is it? And hadn't actually realised that this was the case, despite this being one of the proudest boasts of the university concern. So there's a number of key questions you can ask. But beyond that, and this is the kind of thing we're talking about here today, I think, there are bigger sort of policy level things that we can do. In the institution, nationally, do we require a research and teaching strategy for quality related funding? That's a UK terminology. The REF, the Research Excellence Framework, produces funding for universities, and universities are simply given it to spend, basically. They have quite a lot of freedom as to what they spend it on, where they spend it. There's no requirement or expectation that they declare how it's going to make a difference to teaching. Similarly, when somebody puts in a research grant application, why would they not be asked to think about the impact of it on teaching? And if it is going to have no impact, well, fine, say so, and then one might come to a conclusion about whether they would get all the funding for it. Another thing that we could do nationally is reflect a much more research-related conception of teaching in the national survey. So there are things that we can do. In universities, there's been a long discussion in universities about how we can promote people on the basis of teaching. And it's taken only about 25 years to produce some shift here. Yeah, I am not joking. It has taken that long for many universities to actually move from systems where you only got promoted through research excellence to ones where teaching got some recognition. My suggestion would be, if we promoted on the basis of proven research teaching linkages, you would get a quite significant shift. Because if people wanted to get promoted, they'd have to start thinking about what the relationship was between research and teaching. And getting people thinking, as was mentioned earlier, is a really important aspect of it. The discussion and the debate around this is really important. Secondly, career paths. I think one of the mistakes that many UK universities are going in for is noting that there are a lot of teaching-only staff and setting up separate career paths, called teaching fellow paths or whatever, outside of the academic structure. That inevitably ghettoises, I think, teaching. It is so important to keep teaching in amongst the academic activities. So the academic work is research and teaching and leadership and how those are interrelated. As soon as you separate something out, for very obvious and praiseworthy reasons, because it seems easier to be able to manage it and define it and so on, you take it away from where the prestige is. And we also need to encourage discipline-led discussion of what the link between research and teaching means. Now, that framework that was talked about earlier has been a very interesting one. It's come from the Higher Education Academy, which is a national body for educational improvement in the UK. One of the most important and successful parts of the Higher Education Academy, sadly now gone, was that they had 24 subject centres that dealt with physics, chemistry, whatever. And they worked with those communities to define and improve the quality of teaching. And that was universally regarded as the most successful part of the national body. Makes it all the more puzzling that it was disbanded. So, as my last slide to leave you with, the danger of the relationship between research and teaching is it can be that. And it's really important that we don't have that seesaw, as it were. It's really important that we think of research and teaching as being part of the same thing and construct professionalism upon it. Then we stand a chance of solving some of the problems that we think we see in universities. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Blackmore, for your really interesting presentation. Now we will ask both of you, Javier and Paul, if you please come here to the table, and we will be opening the floor to all of you for questions. Perdoneu. Podem fer qüestions. El secretari d'Universitats demana la paraula. I si us sembla, potser podem fer una primera ronda d'algunes preguntes i passem la paraula als ponents.
Okay, we'll, in the meantime, let's abuse the lectern. So there's a question. First of all, thanks for two illuminating talks. Actually, as a policymaker, I face questions, and you today provided not only some answers, but also some very fundamental additional questions I had not thought about. At the end of the day, as a researcher, I'm a geneticist, so know very little about education research. However, one question I do face, and I would like to hear your thoughts about it, is I would say, easily measure the outcome of an individual as a researcher. I can also easily measure, of course, but by mere addition, the outcome of a department, of a faculty, of a university, because I know there are publications and so on and so forth. But it's extremely complex for me as a policymaker to decide how can I measure the outcome of an individual as a teacher. I can, mind you, I can measure universities and faculties in a way beyond satisfaction. But how I come about the issue of measuring somebody and then, of course, rewarding performance.
En realidad, comentas que es fácil medir la calidad de la investigación, pero no es tan fácil. No es tan fácil. De hecho, ahora es fácil porque tenemos puesto encima de la mesa un sistema muy complejo de medición de la investigación. Un sistema que empieza porque dices, es fácil porque puedo contar el número de publicaciones en diversas publicaciones, tengo un sistema de cuartiles, tengo un sistema de bases de datos, pero en realidad todo empieza en un sistema de evaluación cualitativa por pares, porque es la única forma de medir la relevancia de una investigación, la calidad de su metodología, etcétera, etcétera, ¿no? El problema es que si nosotros queremos tener una medición también cualitativa y avanzada de lo que es la investigación, debemos poner en marcha un sistema paralelo, sencillamente. Es un sistema de revisión por pares, que tenga en cuenta criterios avanzados de lo que es la docencia. No es ni más, yo creo, ni más ni menos difícil que lo es en la investigación. Solo hace falta poner en marcha el sistema adecuado, que es un sistema paralelo para hacerlo. Y tiene, por supuesto, los mismos problemas que tiene la investigación. Los mismos, porque nuestro sistema de medición de la investigación tampoco es perfecto, en absoluto, ni muchísimo menos. Y tampoco Seguro, aunque llegásemos a un sistema de medición de, por pares de la tarea docente, de la actividad docente, tampoco sería perfecto, en absoluto, no lo sería, pero por lo menos tendríamos un sistema puesto encima de la mesa. O sea, no, lo que tenemos puesto encima de la mesa es un inmenso aparato de medición de la investigación y tenemos un raquítico aparato de medición de la docencia. Ese es un poco el balance.
Thank you. You may well have noticed that I would have missed every single word of that elegant answer, but I'm sure I'm just going to repeat what you've said, and my apologies for this. It is an interesting problem how you decide whether somebody is a proficient teacher or whether you want to reward them for teaching excellence and so on. And I think that in the areas I've been involved in setting up systems like this in institutions, there are several things that you look for. One of them is evidence of impact, which obviously makes problematic what we mean by impact, and also raises issues about the indicators that are available to you, really. And in looking across institutions and indeed nationally, I've found that some people have a huge advantage because they're in systems that collect data quite routinely about the quality of teaching. And others simply don't. So you've got somebody who comes from a business school who can say that over 10 years that they have scored 5.9 on a scale of 1 to 5. And there's other people in classics who say, who give you a couple of quotes and say, well, my students thought this. And so that does raise the issue of what kind of evidence is available, because of course you've got to ask the right kinds of questions, but there needs to be evidence of impact there, I think. Otherwise, any claim is just hot air. Having said that, it's really important that a person should be able to articulate, should be able to say what it is that they bring to teaching and how they view it and how they value it, to be able to make a statement about their position on it and their principles in it. And I think that is one very useful way of getting a sense of where people are with teaching. Another issue is around scholarship in teaching. Now, I'm not arguing that everybody should be writing learned articles in the Journal of Higher Education, etc., because that works for some but not for others. But clearly, being involved in advanced curriculum design issues, curriculum change initiatives and so on, and being able to unpack that, offer some pretty good evidence that somebody has thought their way through the issues and can actually do something with it in the real world. So it's a bunch of those things, I think, that have to be brought together to come to a view.
Thank you very much. Més qüestions, més preguntes? Segur que enllant, eh? Jo, de fet, aprofito que encara us ho esteu pensant, planteo una altra pregunta que jo crec que tiene relación con lo que se ha dicho hasta ahora. Me ha parecido curioso que habéis hablado mucho de la docencia y de los profesores a título individual. Y os quería preguntar por la función de los equipos docentes. ¿Qué papel le asignáis? ¿Creéis que vamos a cada vez más a trabajar bajo la concepción de equipos docentes, o realmente seguís pensando en el profesor a título individual, a todos los efectos, en el aula, evaluando, siendo evaluado? Lo digo porque me ha chocado un poco que habéis hablado poco de los equipos y muchísimo de los profesores a título, que lo entiendo, ¿eh? porque es así, pero ¿vais a ver o pensáis que va a haber una tendencia hacia a trabajar en equipos docentes, con todo lo que conlleva, ¿eh? A nivel pedagógico, a nivel de evaluación, etcétera, ¿no?
Sí, posiblemente hemos insistido en la idea individual por una razón, porque es lo que habitualmente asociamos a la idea de prestigio, ¿no? Pero efectivamente existe un prestigio colectivo, existe un prestigio de grupo, ¿no? De hecho, yo con esta pregunta tuya la repregunto hacia Paul, ¿no? En el sentido de hasta qué punto la existencia del National Student Survey o la existencia del UK PSF ha impactado en el prestigio docente de las universidades, el prestigio de los equipos docentes vinculados a un título cuando obtengan, ¿no? Porque yo creo que en el fondo de tu pregunta está, ¿es posible poner en marcha un sistema de prestigio de los equipos y no solo de los individuos? Y porque eso tendría un importante impacto, ¿no? También sobre el prestigio individual para articular internamente esa cultura de la académica, ¿no?
Right, thank you. This is a very challenging thing to do. I think I understood you. Thank you. I think this is one of the things that the UK government is trying to tackle at the moment and is likely to fail at, because the question it's asking is a really, really hard one. If we think about global league tables, one of the reasons they are prestige measures is that what they mainly measure is research. And that is because it's very easy to count Nobel Prizes and other things of that kind. Research outcomes and outputs seem to, you know, are easier to quantify. And so the real problem is, how do you put a value on the quality of teaching that works internationally, across all social settings, across all cultures? How can you say that teaching is truly excellent? And one of the problems with that, that the government is wrestling with at the moment, is the value added problem, which is, how can you possibly say what difference a university made to an individual student or a group of students, unless you've measured where they were at the beginning and you've measured where they are at the end? You have a problem that the most prestigious universities have students who don't need teaching anyway. It's called polishing gold in the trade, really, where they'll get through no matter what. And there are other institutions that take students from very difficult backgrounds who may achieve not a lot in comparison with some other students, but may achieve a great deal for them. So there are huge difficulties in measuring that. And government is determined to find a way of looking at, of understanding value added that works across all disciplines and across the system. I think it's impossible. I don't see how you can do it. I do not see how you can come to any meaningful measure that shows how somebody doing a physics degree has learned on the same kinds of scales as somebody who has done a theatre studies degree. I just can't imagine how it would be done, and yet it's being attempted, and it's principally because of this issue of how do you reward those who are consistently excellent. And if you followed this at all, no reason why you would necessarily. What our government is saying is, if you can show that you are excellent, then we will allow you to charge more for your students. So it's directly related to the fee that you can charge the students. Now, there is a little issue there, incidentally, as an aside. Why you give more money to people who are already doing a job very well, I don't quite understand. It's a very unusual market. But there we are. So I cannot see that we will actually, in the foreseeable future, I don't think we will produce that kind of objective measure of teaching quality. It will always have to be contextualized, because it is a context-related activity. So it will always be difficult to do that. And I think, therefore, you have to make some quite sophisticated judgments, and it always will be a more difficult message to put across. So I failed to answer the question, and that's because I don't think anybody knows how to answer that question. It is an endemic problem. The research is easier to measure than teaching, so there will always be this prestige issue. You then have to find new ways, I think, of giving teaching prestige that aren't quantitative, because you can't do quantitative.
Thank you. Més preguntes? Sí, sisplau. I aquí també, aquí al darrere, aquí al davant.
A partir de las dos intervenciones que habéis hecho, creo que uno deduce por la aportación que hacías tú de cuatro escalones de excelencia docente, digamos, por decirlo de alguna forma, en la cual ir subiendo en esos escalones supone de alguna forma ir aumentando la investigación, por decirlo de alguna forma, en la docencia. Paralelamente, debemos introducir nuestra investigación, no docente, sino la investigación que cada uno tenga en su área, a introducirla también en parte en la docencia. Yo no sé cómo estáis vosotros, pero la investigación, supongo, en todos los campos, cada vez está más, digamos, imposible. Es decir, la presión que tenemos en la investigación en todos los campos es elevadísima, cada vez más. Realmente la curva es, casi diría, vertical. Lo siento, lo veo imposible. Lo veo directamente imposible. La única manera que veo de poder conjugar todo eso es que uno se dedique, es decir, la única manera de subir en esos escalones es que uno sea pedagogo, es decir, que su investigación coincida con la docencia. Si no, lo lamento, pero es que yo lo veo imposible. Lo veo absolutamente imposible.
A mí lo que me parece, yo creo que tienes toda la razón, ¿eh?, en la apreciación que haces, ¿no? Solamente que, siguiendo con tu argumentación, es este sistema, ¿cómo hemos llegado a este sistema? Pues hemos llegado, lo hemos construido en función de determinadas creencias y valores que nosotros mismos teníamos, porque somos nosotros los que hemos creado el sistema, nosotros globalmente, colectivamente. En realidad, todo este sistema un poco enloquecido, ¿no?, de la investigación que hemos creado, ¿no?, todo este sistema es nuestro, no es de nadie, no nos lo ha impuesto nadie. Es el modo en que nosotros hemos llevado esos valores y creencias de nuestro ecosistema, que en buena medida están ligadas a la investigación, nos ha llevado a ir buscándonos este tipo de medidas comparativas, ¿no? Yo creo, de verdad, que hemos llegado muy, muy lejos, ¿no?, en ese, y que a veces ni siquiera estamos produciendo, en términos puramente de investigación, estamos produciendo investigación verdaderamente relevante en nuestro sistema. O sea, creo que, incluso mirando desde el propio ámbito de la investigación, creo que se ha llegado demasiado lejos, ¿no? Pero si miramos institucionalmente, yo lo veía muy, muy claro hace poco en mi institución, ¿no? Dices, si miramos globalmente, resulta que ahora este sistema está propiciando a aquellos, o sea, está promocionando a aquellos profesores que se encierran en su despacho o en su laboratorio, se dedican a sus papers y pasan absolutamente de todo el resto de la institución, de todos los estudiantes, es decir, de todo lo que es importante, no solo para la universidad, sino para la sociedad en general, porque ni siquiera el sistema asegura la relevancia social de la investigación que se está haciendo, sino sencillamente su revista, su review en la revista adecuada, ¿no? Es decir, no hemos llegado muy lejos en este sistema, no deberíamos revisarlo para intentar acomodarnos a lo que la sociedad requiere de nosotros, ¿no? No es una alegación contra la investigación, todo lo contrario, ¿no? Yo creo que tenemos que buscar precisamente la relevancia de la investigación y tenemos que equilibrar lo que es importante que las universidades hagamos con lo que es importante para nosotros, porque en estos momentos ese equilibrio no existe. Lo que es importante en nuestra carrera profesional es en muchos casos, no siempre obviamente, es en muchos casos poco importante para nuestra función social. Y ese es un mal balance.
Right. Thank you. Yes. Is that okay?
Yes.
Can I answer that question?
I
had huge sympathy with the point that's being made, because it always feels like we're asking faculty to do more and more and more with less and less. That's why we need to rethink the whole thing, and which is what I'm arguing for, really, and I think that's what you were saying. My first point is, when we're talking about scholarship in teaching, I think it's easy to start thinking that it might be about writing articles in rather abstract journals. It might be that, but it might equally be producing change in an institution that is evidence-informed, that is working in an evidence-based and thoughtful way. In other words, really, being as thoughtful about teaching as you would be about research. It's an interesting notion that it's almost as if we have two heads. One, the research head, which is evidence-informed, and the other one, the teaching, which is not largely evidence-informed at all. We need to rethink that one, I think. But just to give a concrete example of how one could treat this issue differently, in the UK, I actually run a course, which I can carry on doing because I think it's valuable, for new young academics. And it's an introduction to higher education, really. And the way I cast it is, here you are in an educational jungle at the start of your career. How are you going to get through it? And it's about teaching, and it's about research. It's about leadership and management, but leadership and management is all part of teaching and research, because you don't just lead and manage in the abstract. You lead teaching, which is a leaderly thing in itself, and you lead research. If you're going to be a good researcher, you are leading. And so by starting off from the point of view of saying, here at the beginning of your career, you are doing this complicated thing, and it's all interrelated, and there's a set of values and behaviours that help you through that. That, I think, is a much better way than going to someone and saying, yes, your back is already broken, let me now load this other thing on. Of course you can't do that. You have to rethink. That's what I think we're arguing for.
Estoy de acuerdo. Lo único que creo que la manera de hacerlo, quizá lo que hagamos es repetir los errores que hicimos o que se hicieron potenciando de forma exagerada la balanza hacia la investigación, de forma que ahora la potenciemos y los separemos, porque es simplemente imposible seguir los dos caminos a un nivel en el que estamos ahora mismo y en el que vamos a ir. Lo único es que seamos conscientes de que esa potenciación de las mantener el peso en un lado y hacer exactamente el mismo peso en el otro lado, solo puede llegar a separarlos. Y creo que eso tampoco es bueno. Sí, sí. Creo que en eso coincidimos con, bueno, coincido con el profesor Blackmore.
Sí, yo creo que es una reflexión interesante. Yo creo que en esa medida la idea de scholarship, ¿no? La idea de scholarship que viene con Boyer, la idea de en concreto de scholarship of teaching and learning, ¿no? De esa idea de ir más allá del discovery para la idea de integración, es decir, al final el ser académico para nosotros son nuestros valores y yo creo que son valores muy, muy, realmente muy importantes, ¿no? Entonces, la dificultad está en encontrar no exactamente la misma fuerza en el otro lado de la balanza, ¿no? Porque evidentemente al final el fiel de la balanza se va a romper, ¿no? Es imposible, ¿no? Mantener la misma presión, ¿no? Sino, y esa es la dificultad, un poco en la línea que el profesor Blackmore decía, ¿no? Es encontrar los canales de comunicación entre los dos platillos, ¿no? Entonces, encontrar los canales de comunicación entre los dos platillos, ¿no? Eso significa que, por supuesto, cuando pensamos en nuestras disciplinas y en la enseñanza de nuestras disciplinas, yo siempre he pensado que la clave de una buena enseñanza de una disciplina está en su propia epistemología y que la gente que conoce en profundidad la epistemología de su propia disciplina suele entonces desarrollar enseñanzas realmente interesantes, ¿no? Para hacerlo. Es decir, al final la clave de la gran enseñanza está dentro de la disciplina. Yo creo que está en el corazón de la idea de scholarship, ¿no? Entonces, yo creo que es ahí donde tenemos que empezar a buscar soluciones que evidentemente no son fáciles, ¿no? Ni existen, ni creo que existan recetas, ¿no? Para hacerlo, ¿no?
Professor Blackmore and Javier Parisi, thank you very much for your presentations. I found them very interesting, particularly because I have come across in my professional life with this constant resistance to change, and I kind of guessed it was linked to prestige, but nobody has ever put it out so bluntly to me. And I think that it's really interesting because in a way, to me, that appeals to something slightly negative, or that I considered in the past to be somehow negative, and in a way it's very intelligent to say up front, well, that's what it is, and let's work with it, rather than trying to change it. But I'm still, in my previous way of thinking, I'm still thinking to what extent appealing to the ethical responsibility of teachers works with them. I don't know if you have encountered that in the past, because if you take, for example, the issue of employability, I mean, teachers, besides their careers and besides their prestige and articles and so on, they do have a big role to play in the future of thousands of students that are going to encounter difficulties when they leave their studies. A lot of them will find themselves without a job or doing something that they really didn't think they would ever do, disappointed as to the development of their educational life. So to what extent appealing to that, those kind of values in teaching, not only in research and the impact it has socially, but also in teaching, to what extent do you think that works in, for example, teacher training programs or in your relationship with academics? Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Have a go at it. Yeah, yeah. I think that's a really interesting problem, one of getting faculty to be interested in employability issues. Really, I guess it is something that doesn't bear on them directly, and so it's hard to get people interested. My sense of it is that it takes a very long time to get change of that kind, and you don't get it unless you have changed the model of what it is to be academic. There are many academics who would say it's not my business to make students more employable. There are still people who think that. They tend to think that until their own children go through university, and then they change their views. So part of the problem is that this sort of usefulness thing is not fully part of what many academic people think they should be doing. And it comes back to this issue of the sort of the impact argument over research. That if we start far more to recognize and reward academic staff on the basis of the difference what they do makes, and part of the difference is to do with employability, then you might start to get a change. But it's got part of a bigger cultural thing, which is the outside world does really matter, and we must take note of the contribution we make to the outside world. So there's a larger sort of there's a reasoning exercise to be done, which will have limited effect, I suspect. And there's also changing the recognition and reward structures. Again, if you foregrounded employability, you would find that people would be far more interested, I suspect.
Yo creo que la cuestión ética que planteas es una cuestión muy importante. Yo creo que tiene dos respuestas, ¿no? Yo creo que individualmente, obviamente que cuenta, ¿no? En el sistema que antes retratábamos, hemos visto en un sistema que está basado sobre todo en la investigación y sobre todo en una visión cuantitativa, ¿no? de la investigación, aunque tenga una base cualitativa inicial, ¿no? En ese sistema hemos estado viendo todos estos años, conforme esa presión de la que comentaba antes el compañero subía, hemos estado viendo un montón de profesores dedicando muchísimo trabajo, muchísimo esfuerzo a su docencia. Así que simplemente por el compromiso, sin que le reportasen nada más allá que el compromiso con sus estudiantes, ¿no? Así que la cuestión ética está obviamente presente, ¿no? Pero obviamente no se puede pedir más allá. La pregunta que yo devuelvo es claro que la empleabilidad o la formación de nuestros estudiantes, el desarrollo de nuestros estudiantes, es una contribución esencial. ¿Dónde se está liderando dentro de tu propia institución ese valor? ¿Dónde se está liderando ese valor dentro del sistema? Porque si la ética es simplemente nuestra ética individual, entonces tenemos un problema. Porque si tenemos las dos cosas desalineadas, ¿cuánto tiempo va a resistir este lado? Claro que hay un compromiso ético, lo hemos visto de todos estos años, ¿no? Pero necesitamos articular institucionalmente y sistémicamente, necesitamos articular esos valores para que funcionen. O de lo contrario, el desequilibrio al final va a acabar agotando a todo el otro al lado individual, ¿no? Para hacerlo. La ética no es simplemente una ética individual, es una ética institucional. Entonces, en el momento, yo veo las universidades y el valor de promover la empleabilidad. ¿En cuántas universidades estamos viendo a la gente evaluar y diagnosticar con rigor la empleabilidad que está generando? Y no me estoy refiriendo a las encuestas de inserción laboral, que es otra,
es otra cosa, ¿no? Empleabilidad significa la forma en que formamos a nuestros estudiantes, ¿no? Que desarrollamos a nuestros estudiantes para tener éxito después en su carrera profesional, ¿no? ¿Dónde estamos haciendo evaluaciones de verdad en profundidad de nuestros currículos cuando nos repartimos nuestros currículos entre los intereses de los departamentos? ¿Dónde está eso institucionalmente? Entonces, debemos empezar a organizar eso institucionalmente, o de lo contrario, no haremos grandes avances. Yo estoy con lo que decía el profesor Blackmore, estos cambios son complejos, y creo que lo son en gran medida porque nuestras organizaciones son muy complejas, son muy grandes, y tienen un montón de creencias muy, muy arraigadas, ¿no? Y es difícil cambiar esas creencias, pero el único cambio, yo recuerdo un informe muy valioso de la EUA de hace unos años, ¿no? Verdaderamente inspirador, ¿no? En el que decía, es que no se trata de innovación, no se trata de formación docente, se trata de liderazgo dentro de las instituciones. Y eso es lo que allana el camino para el cambio, ¿no?
Doncs moltes gràcies, no tenemos tiempo para más. Agradecer de nuevo las dos presentaciones, las dos contribuciones. Tenemos ahora una pausa café hasta las 12 y nos vemos a las 12. Gracias.